Hey, it's good to see you tonight. Glad that you're here. It's good to have the youngsters back in here tonight for this evening. Appreciate them being here. Let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer. After we pray, you remain standing. And hey, it's just our regular Wednesday night program tonight. So let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for the chance to be at church. I pray that you'd bless now, once again, the preaching, the singing, all that's done. Lord, I pray that you'd help us tonight, Lord, to put away the cares of the day, the cares of tomorrow. Lord, as we meet together here in the middle of the week, and I know folks are tired, been to work, been here every night. Lord, I just pray that once again, you'd minister to our hearts. Holy Spirit, speak to each one of us. Use Brother Swanky again. Lord, we're going to thank you for what you choose to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.
Amen. Let's sing page 42, Saved by the Blood, on that first verse. Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Second, saved by the blood of the crucified one, the angels rejoicing because it is done. A child of the Father, join heir with the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Let's go and take a moment to greet one another this evening. Amen. Let's sing on that last, saved by the blood of the crucified one, on that last verse. Saved by the blood of the crucified one, all hail to the Father, all hail to the Son, all hail to the Spirit, the great three in one. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved, saved. My sins are all pardoned. the blood of the crucified one.
Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. I'm glad we have the words to that song up there. I heard someone say one time, a long time ago, when they were a child and they couldn't really read real well, and they would hear the song, and some of the folks were singing, "Glory, I'm saved," and other folks were singing, "Saved." And as the little girl, she said, "I thought folks were singing, 'Sorry, I'm saved.'" So we got the words up there so you won't get that mixed up. Hey, I appreciate you being here tonight, and I thank you folks that have been here every night. My, hasn't the Lord met with us? It has been amazing. Thank you for being here. If you missed, I want you to go back and listen to the preaching. I know it'll be a blessing to you. I've said this before that, when you go back and listen to it, one of the things, you get it on your computer. One of the things, you can put it on a little faster play so you can get it done, so you can get through it. I don't know that you could do that with Brother Swanky because he talks so fast. You wouldn't be able to understand it if you boost the speed any at all, but I would encourage you to do that. I know those messages are worth listening again. Hey, we're going to forego with the announcements tonight. I want to go ahead and get to your prayer sheet. We want to have a time of prayer. This is our Wednesday night program, and I want you to be updated on some of the folks that we certainly need to pray for. On our church members, would you be sure and pray for Miss Dot? Miss Dot's best friend at the nursing home passed away today. Some of you have been there to visit her. You may have met Miss Miriam. And Miss Miriam went to heaven today. And she was the one, 3 years ago when Miss Dot went to the nursing home, Miss Miriam was the one who kind of took her in and just showed. They were bosom buddies. Meet every night for prayer. Go and visit the other folks in different halls. She said Miriam was her eyes, and she would lead her around. Of course, they're both in their wheelchairs. They're walking in their wheelchairs. But pray for Miss Dot. Pray for Miss Miriam's family. Her dad was a preacher. She knew she was saved. She always had a good spirit. Always had a good spirit. I just found out that she went in the hospital about 3 weeks ago. My wife and I were there visiting with Miss Dot, and Miss Miriam was there as well, and we had a good conversation. I thought then she didn't look real healthy, but it's a good thing that she's in heaven. It's a good thing, and Miss Dot realizes, and she knows, hey, I'm glad that she's in heaven, and I know we're not supposed to grieve. And I said, no, ma'am, you can grieve. You can grieve. We just don't grieve as others which have no hope. Seems like I heard that this week. I said, it's okay. It's okay, but you know where she's at. And so she was doing better this afternoon. So pray for her, please. Pray for her. And then also, if you would add to our church members, Brother Ed Reeves, Mike Reeves' dad, he came down with COVID. So pray for him, Mr. Ed Reeves, if you would add him to the church members. Just found that out this evening. In our non-church members, some folks we need to add that we didn't get on the prayer sheet this week. If you'd add Barry Durbin, having some heart issues, pray for Barry Durbin. That's Miss Durbin's son. That's Miss Rhonda Reeves' brother. Many of us know Brother Barry. Pray for Barry with some heart issues going on there. And then if you would add also Jim and Molly Gullidge. Again, many of the folks that have been to Smite know Brother Jim and Miss Molly. Brother Jim had a stent put in today. And last time that happened, he did not do well with it. So we want to pray that things go well with Brother Jim. And Miss Molly is having a kidney issue. So pray for Miss Molly. Pray for them. Faithful servants to the Lord for years and years. So do pray for Jim and Molly Gullidge again. We've had them on our prayer sheet off and on. Then if you would add Gwen LeMay, L-E-M-A-Y. This is Brother Booty's sister-in-law, Gwen LeMay. This is Miss Juanita, Miss Booty, Miss Juanita Booty's sister. They called in hospice yesterday. And she's ready to step into glory. And so pray for the family and pray for Miss Gwen LeMay. Pray for that family. And then our new folks in the right-hand column there, Missionary Ben Turner. This is the father of Brother DJ's friend, Brother DJ, and Brother Spielman were in class together there at Golden State. And the son, what was his name? Caleb Turner. Is also a missionary, but Missionary Ben Turner has a disease that's very how did they say? Very unusual. Not many folks have had this thing, and so pray for missionary Ben Turner. The Lord knows there. They've got to find out exactly what it is, but they know it's not anything normal. They thought it would be cancer, growths in his brain and in other parts of his body, little tumors, but it's something else. And so it's a very, very unusual. So pray for him. Pray for the work there. He's missionary up in Canada, right? British Columbia. Missionary to British Columbia. So pray for the Turner family. Pray for the ministry there. Also, Brother P.C. Rodriguez. Many of us know Brother P.C. He was having some issues, been having some issues for several weeks now. Pray for P.C. Rodriguez. And, of course, the Oakwins, Peter and Harmony. They are the couple that lost their baby. That's Miss Melody's daughter. And so let's pray for Miss Melody and the family, as well as Peter and Harmony Oakwin, and their little baby Xavier passed away after a week here on earth. If you would also add to our non-church members, Ina Grantham. Ina, I-N-A, Grantham, G-R-A-N-T-H-A-M. Miss Ina began coming several weeks ago when Brother DJ and Brother Josh knocked on her door and witnessed to her, and she was already saved, and she said, I was just thinking about coming to that church. I guess it's God's. Well, she's been back. But she has COVID also, so pray for Miss Ina. She ought to be getting over it by now if it's the regular COVID on this round. She's had it for about a week. So pray for Miss Ina, and we'll remember these folks. Amen? So let's go ahead and have a time of prayer. I'm going to pray, and then we're just going to continue with the service. Lord, I thank you for the chance to bring these needs to you. And Lord, I thank you that you do answer prayer. And Lord, tonight we especially want to thank you for helping folks that have been through surgeries. Lord, for the Bizettes, thank you for doing well for Miss Libby. Pray that you continue to help them. Lord, I pray also for Miss Dot today. Lord, I pray that you just give her comfort this evening. Lord, be with the other folks there in the nursing home, the friends, Miss Miriam, and Lord, be with her family. Lord, again, thank you that she's with you, but we're asking for comfort and grace for the folks that are left behind. Lord, I thank you that Miss Miriam's no longer suffering health issues all her life. Lord, I thank you that she's with you now and can enjoy a healthy body and to be able to get around like she has never been able to do. So, Lord, thank you for that, but Lord, do be with the family now. I pray also for the Hunts family as they're there in Honduras. I pray for them. I pray that you give them safety as they travel back here in a couple of days. Lord, I pray that you give them reward for the effort there. Lord, I pray also for Brother Reeves, Brother Ed Reeves. Lord, I pray that you'd heal him from the COVID. Also, Miss Ina Grantham. Lord, I pray that they'd have no complications. Lord, it'd just be a minor situation there. Lord, help them to get healthy really, really quickly. Lord, for Brother Barry's heart issue. Lord, you know what's going on there. And Lord, he's had to deal with this similar things in the past. I pray that this time, Lord, you'd help the doctors to be able to be able to heal him. Or Lord, you can heal him. Lord, I just pray that you'd give them grace and strength. And Lord, we pray for Barry and Ashley. Lord, we pray for the Gulledges, for Jim and Molly. Lord, I pray for them. Lord, faithful servants in children's ministry for years and years. And now, Lord, I pray that you'd strengthen them with their health issues. Brother Jim with his heart, Miss Molly with the kidney issues. Lord, I pray that you'd be with them tonight. Lord, also for Miss Gwen LeMay and the family there. Lord, I pray for Miss Juanita's sister. I pray that you just give grace. And Lord, I pray that you'd help the family as they go through this process that many of us have been through. But Lord, it's never easy, never easy. So be with them. Be with them. Lord, they're confident that she knows you. But Lord, just be with that family, please. And Lord, they'll, I'm sure, give you praise and glory. Lord, I pray for our new folks that we have here. Lord, I pray for the Turner family. I pray for Brother Ben. I pray for him. I pray for his work there in British Columbia as he's not able to minister now in the hospital and having tests run. Lord, whatever this thing is that's going on in his body, I pray that you'd heal it. Lord, if you choose to use the doctors, give them wisdom. Lord, help this to possibly even be a blessing for other folks as they treat this unusual disease. But God, I pray that you'd strengthen him. Lord, thank you that it's not cancer, but Lord, this thing, we just need you to work, and we need you to give wisdom, and we'll thank you for that. Lord, I pray also for Brother P.C. Rodriguez. Lord, I pray that you'd strengthen him with his breathing issues and the things that's going on there. Lord, for the Oakwins, God, I pray for them. Lord, I pray for Miss Melody and the family. Lord, I pray that you'd give them strength and comfort and grace. Lord, a difficult time in their life. Lord, they're going through a deep, dark valley. But Lord, I pray that you'd help them to lean on you, depend on you. Holy Spirit, would you work in their lives in such a way that there's no way that they can refute that you were not there. Lord, I pray that you just make it so obvious for them. Take care of their needs. Comfort them, give them grace and strength. Now, Lord, bless our service tonight. Lord, would you meet with us again? And we're going to thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, our missionary letter tonight is from the Barnes family. The Barnes family, there are missionaries to Guam, Micronesia, and the letter is on the back of your prayer sheet, so I'm not going to take time to read it for you tonight. Be sure and read that letter. They went through a typhoon, which is a hurricane in that neck of the woods. And I'll be honest with you, I didn't know it. I did not know it until he sent the letter out. Didn't pay attention to the news closely enough. So do read that letter, and let's continue to pray for the Barnes family, our missionaries to Guam. Amen. Well, let's stand together. We'll join in singing again. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know.
On that first... In this world I've tried most everything, and I'm happy now to say there is nothing like religion in the good old-fashioned way. I am walking in the old-time way, and I want the world to know that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. There's nothing like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. I'm walking in the grand old highway, and I'm telling everywhere I go that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. And there are many things I'd like to be as my journey I pursue. I would long to be a leader like an immortal man would do. I would like to be a millionaire with a million to bestow, but I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. There's nothing like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. I'm walking in the grand old highway, and I'm telling everywhere I go that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. On that last, all the world is bright since I got right. Now I sing and pray and shout. All my burdens have been lifted since the Savior brought me out. I will tell the world both far and near as I travel here below that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. There's nothing like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. I'm walking in the grand old highway, and I'm telling everywhere I go that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know.
Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. Once again, it's good to have your brother Swanky tonight. And folks, I know that you're thrilled that he's here. I want us to listen, pay attention. And if you don't get enough in these last 3-4 days, he's got a table out there with messages. He's got a table out there. I'll tell you the ones I want you to pick, because I'm going to choose some of those for myself, and you'll get to hear those again. So I'd rather you not read those. But no, I'm just kidding. But I want you to take advantage of the opportunity to listen to more preaching. What a blessing. And hey, enjoy, because you know, tonight you're getting the filet mignon. You're getting the T-bone steak. You know, you're getting the ribeye steak or whatever it is that you think is the best. Sunday, we're back to chicken nuggets. You know, fish sticks. So let's enjoy the feast tonight. Brother, come ahead.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much, preacher. God bless you tonight. Let me invite you to turn in your Bible to the book of Luke in chapter number 5. Luke chapter number 5 tonight, and I'd like to begin reading from Luke 5 and verse number 5. And as you're turning there, I certainly like to take a moment and say thank you so much to Central Baptist Church. I just enjoyed this week immensely, just a great time, and I'm grateful and thankful for what God is doing. Of course, there's a great heritage here, but all that means is that why we've got to trust the Lord for tomorrow. And I'm thankful for your pastor's vision and your heart to serve God and say, by the grace of God, we're going to step out by faith and attempt mighty works for him. And I'm just encouraged in these days to see what God is doing in this place. And I just want to encourage you to join your pastor and say, let's do a work for God. I've just enjoyed being with Brother Bartlett this week. Your pastor's a real blessing. He's just a refreshing kind of guy. You know, I love to be around a preacher like Brother Bartlett. It's just a good time of fellowship. Number two, he knows where the best restaurants are. I got to tell you, it's just an amazing thing. If he ever quit preaching, he could write a food magazine or something. But I just enjoyed being with him, and he's just positive and just a refreshing man to talk about preaching, about the Bible, about the things of God. Brother Bartlett, of course, loves the Lord, and he loves you, and he loves Central Baptist Church, and that's all very evident and very obvious, and I just enjoyed my time with him so much, and I'm grateful for him, and just join your preacher. You know, I know the news is bad. Of course it is. What else would we expect? God didn't say it's going to get better and better. What else does worse and worse mean? I mean, right in front of our eyes, we watch it get worse and worse. Perilous times shall come. You say, well, it's dangerous out there. Why are we surprised? If it wasn't dangerous, then we ought to be surprised. That's exactly what God said. And yet in times like these, like never before, God needs his people in his New Testament church to join the preacher and say, let's step out together and join hands. Let's just do a work for God. I love that work, that verse in the Old Testament where God said, Moses, hold the rod up and I'll give you victory. And of course, when Moses began to tire and his arms began to drop, that's when God raised up some men to prop up Moses' arms. And I just think that's a great picture as to what God wants men, and he wants church members to do at a place like Central Baptist Church, as to prop up the arms of the preacher and say, we're in this together, and let's attempt a mighty work for God forward for him until the trumpet sounds and we see our Savior. And you know, that just could be tonight. So how grateful and thankful we are for you folks, for what God does here. Stay faithful, stay encouraged, stay strong in the Lord until we see our Savior, maybe today. Thank you again for being so gracious and kind to me in these days. You have your Bible tonight to the book of Luke in chapter number 5. It was a few months earlier that the mighty soul winner Andrew brought his brother Peter to the Lord Jesus Christ. There the Bible tells us they were on the other side of the Jordan River, perhaps as the crow flies, about 18 miles from Peter's hometown of Bethsaida. There Peter meets the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the time John chapter 1 is done, well, Peter not only gets a new name, he also gets a new heart. And Peter meets the Savior and he bows his knee to the Christ of the Bible. And Peter is forever changed. Well, after that meeting with Christ, Peter returns home to Bethsaida, a little village on the north shores of the Sea of Galilee. There, Peter resumes his fishing business, and as you make your way through Luke chapter 5, there's some clues that tell us that Peter, well, if you got an idea, something in a rowboat with a line in the water, you got the wrong idea. This man, Peter, has a very lucrative fishing business. And why Peter goes back home and back to the fishing business, and there they are doing what fishermen do on the shores and the seas of Galilee. And then one day the Lord Jesus makes his way to Peter. The first time Peter went to Jesus, this time Jesus comes to Peter. And one morning there is going to be a revival meeting on the north shores of the Sea of Galilee. And of course the Bible tells us the massive crowds have gathered. They're everywhere now where Jesus goes. And yet as the Lord Jesus is going to preach a message to the crowd, the truth is on this particular morning, he's preaching to three people, Peter, James, and John. And for all the multitudes and for all the crowd, this is the day where three men's lives would be changed, and they would be changed forever. If you're able physically, could I invite you to stand together with me as we go to Luke chapter 5 and verse number 5. And Simon, of course, is that old name of Peter. Simon is that name that came from the old days. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night. Go down, if you would, to verse number 8. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. This is the morning where Jesus will go from being his master to his Lord. Father in heaven, we ask for your blessing and your help now as we go to the mighty word of God. I pray for someone in this room who has never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, that tonight would be that night they call out to the Savior and you rescue them from their sins and from hell. Then, Lord, I'm praying for your children now that the mighty Bible would do its work and breaking up the fallow ground of our lives. Would you do a work of revival in this place? I pray for that man, that lady, perhaps for a young person tonight, that they would do holy business with God. We ask that you would do your work in this auditorium. We commit the preaching to you. In Jesus' mighty name we come. Amen. Thank you so much. Please be seated. In verse number 1, the Bible says it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. Sometimes it's called in the Bible Tiberias. Sometimes it's called the Sea of Galilee. Here it is called the Sea of Gennesaret. Three names for the same place. And now on the north shores, the Bible tells us that the crowds are pressing. In one verse, the Bible says they're pushing. Another verse says they are tripping, trotting over each other. And the crowds are massive as they come to the shore of the sea to hear the Lord Jesus Christ. Why, it's the perfect place to have an outdoor meeting. I've read that human voices carry 7 times better on the water. Well, Jesus now has a built-in amplifier, doesn't he? And the crowd could sit on the slope as it makes its way down to the water. It pretty much is the perfect outdoor amphitheater. And as the Lord Jesus will go out on a boat and the waters will amplify his voice, well, the Lord Jesus has everything in control like he always does. And I love verse number 1. Because you might have missed it the first time, but there really is a powerful double meaning here, isn't there? The Bible says the multitudes, the people have come, and notice they've come to hear the word of God. Well, that's powerful because, of course, every time Jesus speaks, the words that flow from his mouth are the word of God. But the Bible tells us in John 1:1 that one of the great names of the Lord Jesus Christ is the word of God. So on that morning, well, you might say the people had come to hear the word of God from the word of God. And the Lord Jesus Christ never disappointed them. With the great crowds by the shores of Galilee, the Bible tells us that Jesus delivers his message. You know, somehow we got to get this figured out because the Bible tells us in verse 2 that he saw 2 ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them washing their nets. So as the Lord Jesus gathers not very far away, we get the first inkling that Peter's got quite the fishing business here. Why, the Bible doesn't say there was a little boat, there were ships. And in Peter's day, a situation like this called for 2 great ships. They would work in tandem, pulling mighty nets through the Sea of Galilee. The nets were set up in a pattern where there were buoys holding one net on the top, weights holding another net on the bottom, and then another net would connect the lower net, the higher net, and as these ships would go through the water, well, they would collect a lot of garbage, and they would collect a lot of stuff, but hopefully they would collect a lot of fish. And that was the problem this night, wasn't it? These professional fishermen had spent the night on the Sea of Galilee, and now they come in the morning, and as they're putting their ships into the docks, and they're washing their trammel nets, well, the Bible tells us they didn't catch a thing. And I'm not a fisherman. That's not my idea of a good night. Some of you I know it is, and that's fine. But I got to tell you, I do believe there is a definition or a description for a fisherman who fishes all night and they haven't caught a thing. And I believe the correct terminology is bad mood. And you know, when these men have gone all night, and remember, this isn't a hobby. Remember, these men aren't looking for a day off. This is how they put food on the table. This is how they put clothes on their kids' backs. This is how they pay for the roof over their head. And now these professionals have gone an entire night. They are tired. They are washing the nets. And all they want to do is go home and sleep so that tonight they can go out and they can try it again. And as the ships have come to dock and the nets are being washed, the Lord Jesus is ready to preach to the people. So in verse number 3, he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's. And the Bible says, isn't this fascinating? Jesus prayed him, Simon, that he would thrust out a little from the land. Really? Ever the gentleman, the Lord Jesus, in such a very honorable way, in such a very appropriate way. I mean, ever the gentleman, Peter, would you mind if I use one of your boats so that I could pull out from the shore and address the people? Ever the gentleman, the truth of the matter is the water in that lake, Jesus owns it. And the wood that made the boat, Jesus owns that. And for the record, the grass where everybody was sitting, well, Jesus owns that too. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, and he also owns the Sea of Galilee. The Lord Jesus could have commandeered anything he wanted to. But ever the gentleman, Peter, would you do me a favor? Peter, would you let me go out a bit in the boat? And you and I in America, we understand this thing of returning favors. But in the Middle East, my, it is even a more serious thing than it is for you and me. If I do somebody a favor in the Middle East, they're going to go out of their way to make sure they return that favor. And when we come to Luke chapter 5, well, I guess we have to say that Peter owes Jesus a favor. Because after all, at the end of Luke chapter 4, Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law. Well, then again, maybe not. That's how you want to look at that one, you know. Maybe Peter had a grudge. I'm not exactly sure about that one. But grudge or no, well, the Lord Jesus had washed Peter's sins away. The Lord Jesus had inscribed Peter's name in the book of life. The Lord Jesus wants to use the boat. You get to use the boat. And the Bible tells us the creator of the universe sat down in verse number 3 and taught the people out of the ship. So where do we get off track? You know, in Bible times, just right there in the Word of God there, Brother Bartlett, it says the preacher sat down while the people often would stand up. So what are we doing this backwards for? Well, where do we get off track? In Bible times, in the Word of God, the people stood while the preacher sat. Nowadays, we're doing this all backwards, and then we wonder why there's no revival. When are we going to get this right? When is Central Baptist Church going to get this thing right? The people stand, the preacher sits. Well, the Bible tells us Jesus sat out of a boat and he began to teach and preach to the people. And of course, in verse number 4, when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. Now, you can read that, and I can read that, and we can, in our best way of thinking, imagine what that must have seemed like. But you know what we can do when we read it, or I should say what we can't do, is we can't hear what it sounded like. And in verse number 4.5, what you and I don't read are the groans and the moans of everybody in that fishing business. Because the last thing they want to do is turn around and get those nets back on those boats, get the boats out of the docks. The last thing they want to do is go out into the Sea of Galilee during the daytime. I mean, after all, these are the professional fishermen. I mean, after all, these are the guys that make their living, though they didn't do too well the night before. They make their living on that lake. They know the Sea of Galilee like they know the back of their hand. And now this Jesus is telling them, all right, fellas, after a long night of nothing, you're tired, you're worn out, you're hungry. All you want to do is go home, eat, and go to bed. I want you to get those boats out of the dock. I want you to wash, take those nets you just washed. I want you to hook them up. And it's not go out a few feet over here or a few feet over there. He said, I want you to launch out into the deep waters of the Sea of Galilee. Can you imagine? I mean, Peter's certainly going to be in a tough spot now. I think there's a word for this because you understand, you know where Jesus was from. He was Jesus of Nazareth. Nazareth is the hill country. I do believe there's a word for this. Somebody from the hill country trying to tell the professional fishing business and these fishermen how to do their job, I do believe under their breath they're using a word like landlubber. Do you know what this would be like? This would be like somebody from the hills of Tennessee Or even worse than the hills of Tennessee, the hills of North Carolina. That's even worse. It'd be like somebody from the deep, deep hills of the Carolinas or Tennessee taking a trip up into New England, finding themselves at a little fishing village in Maine where you have these crusty old lobstermen who have spent their lives out on the Atlantic Ocean. You can't understand a word they're saying. And if you were to go to some crusty little old village out in the middle of the state of Maine on the coast, and there you find these old lobstermen that spend their life out on the Atlantic, can you imagine somebody from the hills of Tennessee showing up and telling those old boys how to get things done? I gotta tell you, that ain't gonna work in a place like Maine. And that isn't gonna work on the shores of Galilee. Who does he think he is? This carpenter's son, is gonna tell us professional fishermen how to fish the Sea of Galilee. What does he know? I mean, everybody knows you don't go out in the daytime. The fish don't swim, they're silent, that's a hot place. If they're anywhere, they come to the shore where the springs come down the hills into the water. Everybody knows there is no fish to catch, there is no work to do. After all, if you could catch fish during the day, the last thing you'd do would be to go work out there all night. And so what we can hear in our Bible is the grumbling and the moaning of the fishing partners. And when Jesus said, launch out into the deep, Simon Peter's got a real problem here, doesn't he? I mean, can you picture him in your mind? Here is his Savior, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who is graciously saying, Peter, thank you. Thank you so much for allowing me to use your boat. And then he says, Peter, why don't you just hook up those nets and why don't you go out into the deep, launch out into the deep. And with Jesus on one side and with the fishing buddies on the other side, we've got Peter right in the middle of things. I mean, if looks could kill, then Peter never would have made it. You can almost see it in your mind as these professional fishermen are saying, not now, not now, this is the wrong time. And they are staring at Peter, don't go there, Peter, don't do this, Peter. And then Peter's looking at the Lord Jesus Christ, and how could you ever say no to the Lord Jesus Christ? I mean, Peter's in a rock and a hard place. So in verse number 5, the Bible tells us Simon answering said unto him, and notice the title, he said, you're my master. Simon Peter answering said unto him, Master, what a title. I wonder when we get to heaven and we get to hear what that sounded like, if we're not going to hear Peter ride that word. I wonder if Peter didn't slow down a little bit and kind of emphasize it so that everybody could hear him. When Simon Peter addresses Jesus as Master, he is saying, Jesus, you are more important than me. You are of higher rank than I am. You are of more important status than I am. That word master would be used for a political leader. It would be used for the king. It was the word you would use for a commander of a ship. It was the word you would use in the military for an officer. It was used in the classroom for the teacher. It was used in the synagogue for the rabbi. And I can hear Peter kind of just heavy on that word, master, as he emphasizes it and he pronounces it clearly. And what he is saying to his buddies is, don't blame me when this goes off the rails. Don't give me a hard time. Somebody more important than me has just given me an order. Somebody who's over me has just told me what to do. Gentlemen, I know what you know and I know there's no fish to catch in the Sea of Galilee when the sun rises. But the master, but the teacher, but the boss, but the one who is higher, but the one who is more important, but the one who's got a higher rank than I have, he has just told me to launch out into the deep. So you can hear Peter say in verse number 5, kind of balancing the whole act, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. And if he didn't stop at the word master, I'm quite certain he really must have emphasized these next words. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Hey, guys, don't blame me. It's his word. We're going to do this because he said so. I don't want to do this. You don't want to do this. Everybody knows this, but we're going to do this because the master said to do it. We're going to go because the king said to go. We're going to do it at his word, not your word, not my word. However, Peter tries to balance this, juggle this, and get out of this mess. On one side, you have a bunch of people that don't do nothing but go home. On the other side, the creator of the Sea of Galilee has just told them not just to launch out into the deep, an enormous amount of work. And what do you know? In verse number 6, when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes in their net break. I mean, they had never had a catch like this before. You say, well, how do you know? Because, well, had they had a catch like this before, they would have had stronger nets, wouldn't they? No, they never had a catch like this before. The nets are breaking. And the Bible says it was so incredible in verse number 7. I love the word here. And they beckoned unto their partners. You know, they didn't scream or yell to their partners. They're starting to do some sign language now. This is kind of like somebody in the California gold rush, and they strike it rich. And you know, when they come back to get a few more axes and get a few more things of equipment, they want to make sure they put on a poker face. They want to make sure nobody knows. They're going to hide it the best they can. And so do you realize what has happened here? I mean, number one, it's during the daytime. And during the daytime, could I use the word? He hit the jackpot. Somewhere on the Sea of Galilee, Peter found the spot. I mean, only Jesus knew it was there, and now Peter knows where it is. There must be an underground spring. There must be something here. It is not just that today is going to be the greatest day of my life. Tomorrow is going to be the greatest day of my life. And by the way, we don't have to work all night. We can do what normal people do. We can sleep all night and come out here in the day. Do you understand? If there was such a thing as the stock market back then, Peter's fishing business stock suddenly just went right to the moon. I mean, everything took off. This was the greatest day of his life. All of a sudden, Peter goes from being clearly a successful businessman to being a very successful businessman. He hit the jackpot. And the Bible tells us when they had this done, in verse number 6, they enclosed that great multitude of fishes and their net break, and they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And the Bible tells us in verse 7, they came and filled both the ships, so they began to sink. They never had a catch like this before. How do you know? Because if they did, they'd have bigger boats. And you know, they did discover a few years ago one of these fishing boats in the bottom of the Sea of Galilee. And of course, the instant they did, religion comes along and says, that was Peter's boat. You know, I'm guessing Peter didn't have the only boat on the Sea of Galilee, but if you've ever been to Israel, it's really the frustrating thing, isn't it? You know, over here, put your shekels in the box and see this. Over here, over here, over here, over here. Well, whether that's Peter's boat or not, it gives us a good idea. And they were quite the machines. They were quite the boats. It was quite the deal for those ships, for them to begin to sink, two of them, under the load of the great fishes. It was a catch like none other. It was an extraordinary moment. And it's not just that Peter had a great day today. Peter is set for the rest of his life. What a moment. And so when the Bible tells us in verse number 8, Peter now back at shore, when he saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. A moment ago, he looked at Jesus and said, you're the master. You're higher than I am. You're more important than I am. I salute you. I respect you. I honor you, like all of us in this building do with the Lord Jesus Christ. A pagan world today took the name of Jesus, and they drag it through the mud, and they stomp it into the ground, and they spit upon him today like they did 2,000 years ago. Our wicked, pagan, godless world, with its Hollywood culture, with its wicked education system, they can't get out of their way fast enough to curse the holy name of Jesus. But in this place tonight are people that love that name, and they honor his name, and they magnify his name. And all of us in this room tonight bow our heads before Jesus the Master. Jesus is greater than we are, higher than we are, more nobler than we are. Jesus is the Master. But now in verse number 8, Peter is going to go to a different level. Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. In New Testament times, the word Lord could be used one of two ways. First, it was a very respectful term. Like in America, we use the word sir. Like some would say, yes, sir, yes, sir, no, sir. That's how the word Lord was used. So on one side of the coin, Peter could be just simply respecting the Lord Jesus Christ with the title Lord. Or the other side of the coin, the word Lord means you are now the king and the ruler of my life. So which one is it? Is Peter being respectful? Or is Peter saying you are now the king of my life? Is Peter saying, Lord, I show great honor to you? Or is Peter saying, my hands off my life. From this point on, you are now the one who rules and reigns over me. And we know, don't we? Because in verse number 8, the Bible says that he fell down at Jesus' knees. For a Jewish man to bow down before any other person would have been an incredibly wicked violation of Moses' Ten Commandments. And yet when Peter bows his knee before the Lord Jesus Christ, he is not just saying you're a good man, a good prophet, a mighty man. He is saying you are God, very God, and I am surrendering my life to you. From this moment on, you are not just my master. From this moment on, you are not just the savior of my life. From this moment on, you are not simply the one who is great and mighty and powerful, the one to whom I show great respect. But from this moment on, you get to rule every day of the rest of my life. And it all happened one morning by the shore of Galilee. Peter went from having Jesus as his master to having Jesus as his Lord. So we're not impressed. After all, why would we be? Because religion is awfully good at claiming that Jesus is Lord. I mean, every religion, Christian religion in America, I mean, Sunday after Sunday, they sing it to the tops of their lungs. He is Lord, he is Lord, he is Lord. But you know, one day as the multitudes that we read about, they were congregating around the Lord Jesus. In the book of Luke, Jesus looked at them and asked them the question, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? You see, the Bible never says, if you love me, wear a t-shirt. If you love me, put a bumper sticker on your car, show you how old I am. If you love me, put out a blog or a tweet. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And it's awfully easy to call Jesus Lord with our tongue, but it is something very different to bow our knee before him and say, you are the ruler of my life. I am removing myself from the throne of my heart. And King Jesus, from this moment on, you rule and you reign over me. So what is it tonight? Oh, we would all sing the chorus, he is Lord, he is Lord, he is risen from the dead, he is Lord. We would all say the verses. We would all quote the themes. We would all say that Jesus Christ is Lord. But is he Lord in your life? Is he Lord in my life? And before we're so quick to answer that, would you go back to the story with me? And from Luke chapter 5, let me quickly give you four simple things that are true in Peter's life when Jesus goes from being his master to his Lord. And as they are true in Peter's life, so they are true in my life and in your life. And if the Lord Jesus rules and reigns, and if he is truly the Lord of our lives, then we don't have to wonder, we don't have to think, we don't have to guess. There are some very evident things that will be true. Notice number one, when Jesus is Lord, that means I live according to the Bible. In verse number 5, Simon answering said unto him, Master, we've toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. What are you doing this for? This is illogical. What are you doing this for? Nobody else is doing this. What are you doing this for? All the experts disagree. What are you doing this for? You know and I know and everybody knows it isn't going to work. And there's only one reason. It may not make sense and I may not understand, but I am going to do what the word of the Lord Jesus Christ says. And ladies and gentlemen, statement of Jesus Christ as Lord. It is not the song we sing. It's not the poem we quote. It's not the sermon we preach. It's not the class we teach. If Jesus Christ is Lord, he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. So when somebody sings that Jesus is Lord, and somebody tweets that Jesus is Lord, and somebody wears a t-shirt that Jesus is Lord, but the Bible is sitting up on the shelf, Jesus isn't Lord of anything. And when you and I think, today I'm going to live according to my word. Today I'm going to live according to my wisdom. Today I'm going to live according to my thinking. Then it doesn't matter what phony games of religion we try to play. Jesus Christ is not Lord. Because when Jesus said Lord, it means that I am spending my life obeying the word of God. And that means I spend my life learning the word of God. That means I spend my life hiding the word of God in my heart. That means I spend my life figuring out how does God want me, according to the Bible, to run my life, to build my family, to have a marriage, to build Central Baptist Church. If Jesus Christ is Lord, that means the Bible is telling us how to live our lives. And if the Bible is sitting on the shelf and we have no regard, then it doesn't matter what we sing. It doesn't matter what we say. It doesn't matter what we claim. If we are not living according to thy word, Jesus is not Lord. When Jesus Christ goes from master to Lord, that means, number one, I live my life according to the Bible. But how about this, number two? When Jesus becomes the Lord of my life, not just the master now, not just the one who saved me months or even years ago, but when Jesus is now the Lord and the ruler of my life, that means that he is worth more than all earthly treasure. Look again at verse number 6. When they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net break. Kaboom! That is the sound of Peter's stock going to the moon. In verse number 9, the Bible says he was astonished. Could I just say, you know, growing up in New England, spending a little bit of time in some fishing villages, to get a crusty old fisherman from the Sea of Galilee to be astonished about anything would be an amazing thing, as you can imagine with the shrimpers and the rest. I mean, those guys, they're not usually stunned. And yet the Bible says that Peter astonished and all that were with them at the draught of the fishes which they have taken. This is the greatest day of their business lives. Please understand what's happening here. This is not the Lord Jesus saying, okay, Peter, I'm going to bankrupt you. Okay, Peter, I'm going to take away your business. Okay, Peter, I'm going to put you in the hospital. Okay, Peter, I'm going to put you on your back. Peter, I'm just going to take away absolutely everything. And when you're helpless and hopeless and broken and empty, and when there's nowhere to turn and nowhere to go, then will you make me the Lord of your life? Yeah, you know, that may be how the prosperity gospel sees it. What can Jesus do for me? But this is not how he deals with Peter. He doesn't bankrupt Peter and say, now what are you going to do? He says, Peter, you got a choice here. You can either be the greatest fisherman in the history of the Sea of Galilee. You could be, could I say, a multimillionaire or whatever that meant to them. Or Peter, you can spend your life serving me, but you can't have both. You know, Peter's got a choice to make here. He said, I'm going to be the greatest fisherman ever, or I'm going to give my life to serve the Lord. I'm going to decide that I'm going to live for everything for now, or I'm going to live for eternity. I'm going to lay up treasures on this earth, or I'm going to lay up treasures in heaven. But Peter is confronted with not an easy choice. This is not the Lord saying, you're going to be miserable until you finally serve me. This isn't the Lord saying, let's go back out on that lake and I'll see if I can find Jonah's great fish or something. This is not Peter, I'm going to ruin you unless... No, this is Jesus saying, Peter, you got it on a silver platter. You know where to go. You know where to fish. You can have it made. Or you can give your life to me. But you can't have both. When Jesus becomes more important than all earthly treasure, a little later in the book of Luke, there'd be a word for that. You cannot serve God and mammon. You know, modern Bibles got rid of the word mammon and dumbed down their Bible and used the word money. However, that's a very poor word. Mammon and money are not the same thing. Mammon certainly includes money, but mammon is a whole lot more than that. Mammon pretty much means stuff. So, Peter, you can live for stuff, or you can live for Christ. But you can't do it both ways. You love me more than your silver? You love me more than your gold? Do you love me more than your fishing business? How about it, Peter? What are you going to do? In the early 1930s, America and the world were in the throes of a Great Depression. And of course, life was incredibly tough and incredibly brutal. And in the middle of everything, there was a man who worked as an insurance clerk in New York City. A young man, he'd recently been married, and he had a great love for the Lord, and he also had a golden voice. I mean, an absolutely golden musical voice, like very few ever had. It would come a day not too much later where he'd be sitting in the offices of a recording company. A very powerful executive would put a contract on the table in front of him, and all he had to do was take a pen. And in the middle of the Great Depression, if he signs that contract, he is going to be incredibly wealthy doing what he loves to do. But when he looked at that contract, he said to the executive, "You know, I'm a Christian, and I don't mind singing your songs, but I need to sing about Jesus too." And the executive said, "That's not what that contract says. We have no room for that." He was battling an awfully tough choice. To make it worse, there was the Depression. Yet one day, he crossed the river into New Jersey, where his mom and dad lived, and he said he was sitting in their living room. He always went to the old piano they had, and he would sit by that piano, and he would play. And on this particular occasion, his mom, an incredibly godly woman, knew the battle that he was facing, the choices he had to make with his life. And she didn't preach at him, didn't put a finger in his face, but she did write a little poem. And when the young man came to the piano and sat down and began to play, he saw that piece of paper, and he stopped and he read the words, and he said 10 minutes later there was a melody under his fingers on that piano, and they matched the words perfectly. He said that never would happen again. It had never happened before. But that day a brand new song was written in the parlor of that living room, and yet more importantly than a brand new song, a choice was made. And a young man in the middle of the Depression turned down an incredible contract, because he knew God had given his voice, and that voice belonged to the Lord. You may have heard his name. Oh, you never really would have heard it in the Hollywood movies, but you may have heard that name. His name was George Beverly Shea. And you know, the words that his mother had written that day would become immortal words. They went like this: "I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold, and I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands." How about this in the middle of the Depression? "I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame, and I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain or be held by sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. When Jesus goes from being master to Lord, when he becomes the king of my life and sits on the throne of my heart, that means that the Lord Jesus Christ is more important than anything this world's got to offer. And it means I'm going to build my life according to the Bible." There's a third choice. Look, if you would, to verse number 8. "When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord.'" Well, there he is, just like Isaiah again. "I'm a sinful man, O Lord." You know, when Peter was there that day, he didn't walk around singing, "I'm somebody special." He didn't walk around patting himself on the back. He didn't enter in a negotiation. He didn't say, "Lord, you got a good deal when you got me." You know, the closer we draw to our Savior and the more we are drawn to him, the more we realize that he is the all and the all and in all, and that we are the absolutely nothing. And that day, Peter realized that "I am so helpless and so unworthy." All he could say was, "Lord, what could you ever find in me?" You know, you and I have absolutely nothing to present to him. We have absolutely nothing to offer him. He doesn't need our advice. He doesn't need our thinking. He doesn't need our opinions. He doesn't need one thing that I have. I am the unworthy, helpless sinner saved by grace. He is the almighty, all-knowing, all-powerful creator of the universe. That day when Jesus goes from being the master, my savior, the one for whom I have great respect, to the one who is now the king of my life, Peter has to realize I'm the nothing, he's the everything. And then there is this one other choice, isn't there? In verse number 10, so also was James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. I find that word fascinating because we read it earlier. What was it in verse number 7? When Peter beckoned the partners, yet it's a very clear difference because in verse 7, the partners are business partners. The word that we find in verse number 10 refers to fellowship partners. James and John would be very different than the rest of the fishermen for the rest of Peter's life. And then Jesus said unto Simon, fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. See, when Jesus goes from being master to Lord, Peter says, I'm going to live according to thy word. Peter says, I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold or the greatest fishing business ever. Peter said, I am now the nothing. And ultimately, this is what it means to have Jesus the Lord and the King. Peter is simply saying, for the rest of my life, Jesus gets to tell me what to do. Every single hour of every single day, of every single week, of every single month, of every single decade, for the rest of my life, Jesus gets to run them all. I mean, from the moment that Peter falls on his knees and calls him Lord, and installs Jesus on the throne of his life, the Lord Jesus says, Peter, from this point on, you're no longer fishing for fish. You're fishing for men. You're going to catch men. You're going to set. That really was a word they would use in the military to describe the capturing of a prisoner. And sadly, then they would capture them and torture them. Jesus was saying, Peter, you're going to capture them, and then you're going to set them free from their sins. For the rest of your life, you're going to travel the known world. And Peter would. He would go all the way to Babylon. He would go all the way to what we know as the land of Iraq. They would send missionaries and start churches all over what we know as the land of Turkey. And Peter would give his life traveling the known world, telling sinners about the Savior, until one day, just as Jesus promised, they stretched out his arms and they crucified Peter. Peter, from this moment on, I get to tell you what to do. I get to tell you where to go. I get to tell you how to live until you die. That's what it means when Jesus is the Lord. See, that's why it's a whole lot easier to carve out 30 minutes on a Sunday morning, put on a t-shirt, get a Starbucks in this hand, and wave towards heaven with this hand and tell Jesus how much you love him, and then walk out the door and spend the rest of the week living for me, doing what I want, behaving like I want, having the entertainment that I want, going where I want. It's a whole lot easier to carve out 30 minutes and think we've done Jesus a big favor. But it's something very, very different to say, from this moment on, every second of my life, you run it. Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? You think Jesus was impressed by the screams and the cries, Lord, Lord? You think Jesus is impressed when 10,000 people file into a house of religion? And on a Sunday morning, they all sway back and forth singing that Jesus is Lord. Do you think that impresses him? Do you think that the Lord is impressed because somebody blogs a blog, tweets a tweets, or podcasts a podcast, or whatever that is? Do you think that impresses him? Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? When Jesus goes from being Master Savior to Lord and King, I live my life by the Bible. I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. I am the absolute nothing, and Jesus gets to run every minute of my life. And until we're willing to do those four things, it doesn't matter what we wear, doesn't matter what we say, doesn't matter what we preach, it doesn't matter what we sing, Jesus is not Lord. Years ago in the land of Romania, when the communists had taken power, They convened a congress of all Christian bodies in their parliament building. There were 4,000 ministers, priests, rabbis of all denominations. And all of these religious leaders in Romania had come with the purpose that day. They were going to install the bloody, godless, murderous Joseph Stalin as their honorary president. At that time, of course, he was leading a world movement to obliterate Christianity. But wicked ministers who are not saved never seem to have a problem supporting the Stalins and the Hitlers. It really is amazing. One by one, minister after minister, reverend after reverend, priest after priest stood up, and they sang the praises of Joseph Stalin, that Christianity and communism, why, they can certainly live together. One by one, they exalted Stalin. They praised this wicked butcher. Sitting in that massive auditorium was a Romanian pastor named Richard Wurmbrand. His wife sat next to him, her name was Sabina, and as one by one these ministers were standing up, blaspheming the name of Christ and exalting satanic communism, finally Sabina leaned over to her husband and she said this. She said, "Richard, stand up and wash away this shame from the face of Christ. These ministers are spitting in his face." Richard Wurmbrand leaned over to her husband and or his wife, and he said, "If I do this, you will lose your husband." She leaned over and said, "I don't wish to have a coward for a husband." Glad my wife's not here tonight, bro. Your problem, not my problem. "I don't wish to have a coward for a husband." So Richard Wurmbrand stood up in the midst of those ministers. It was broadcast then by radio across the land of Romania. And in powerful words, he condemned communism for their bloody slaughter. In powerful words, he exalted the Lord Jesus Christ, declaring that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. That Jesus and communism are mortal enemies. They have never meant to exist together. Richard Wurmbrand knew exactly what that meant, and sure enough, he would spend 14 years imprisoned. 3 of those years he was in solitary confinement, which was a cell 12 feet underground. There were no lights, there were no windows. Richard Wurmbrand in his book talked about how he was often beaten and tortured, physically mutilated. One day his flesh would be burnt. The next day they would lock him in an ice box. He said they literally ripped the soles of his feet and beat him until the flesh was gone. And when he wrapped up all of his suffering in his autobiography, he just put it like this: "There are no words to describe the pain." This isn't for everybody. See, the crowd got so big, there were, had to be 20,000 there to get the free meal. Free Filet-O-Fish sandwiches, here they come. You know, everybody jokes. And it's not funny unless there's a grain of truth that if you have a meal, there's a big crowd. It's nothing new. It's exactly what happened with Jesus. Big meal, big miracles, big crowd. And then you come to Luke 14. And that's where Jesus said, "You're going to be my disciple? Really? Let me tell you what this means." Pretty much kind of the same thing he does with Peter. And by the time they get around to singing the invitation song to the Luke 14 message, he's whittled the crowd down to 12. And one of them was a devil. Now, there's a multitude of people by the lake, but the message is for Peter, James, and John. Gentlemen, today you have a choice to make. You can live for fish or you can live for Christ. You can live for treasures or you can lay your treasures up in heaven. You can live for now or you can live for eternity, but you can't do both. And when you and I are willing to live our lives by the Bible, when you and I love Jesus more than all the treasures of the world, when you and I humbly bow our heads and say, "I am nothing," and when the Lord Jesus is going to be able to tell me or you how to live every day of our lives, then Jesus becomes Lord. And without that, it doesn't matter what the t-shirt says. Doesn't matter what the chorus sounds like. Doesn't matter how big the multitude is. From Master to Lord. Most in this building have Jesus the Savior. All in this building, you wouldn't be here if you didn't have great respect for Him. But it is something very, very different to get on our knees and say, Lord, You run my life. Tonight, if you're not saved, Brother Bartlett would love to have somebody sit down with a Bible and show you from God's Word how to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved, not by works, not by works, not by works of righteousness which we have done. A sinner like me needs the Savior. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Would you let us help you from the Bible? You can leave this building tonight knowing your sins are gone. Jesus, your Savior. You know Him as your Savior? Well, the invitation of Luke 5 is extended. Is He your Master? Is He your Lord? Father in heaven, I pray that even now You would do a work in this place that a preacher could never do. And Lord, in a world of religion that sings about Jesus, talks about Jesus, speaks about Jesus, You must look across our country at the massive houses of religion saying, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? Lord, I pray that great conviction would fall upon this auditorium tonight. And if someone sits here without Jesus, may this be the night they're saved. I pray as well for your children that the Word of God would grab the heart of that man, that lady, or maybe even a young person here tonight. And at this altar, may there be someone who says, I love my Savior. He will be the Lord, the King, the ruler of my life. I wonder, before I finish praying, if someone tonight would say, preacher, I'm the one who needs to be saved. I don't know, according to the Bible, that Jesus Christ has taken my sins away. And preacher, I'm concerned about my soul. Pray for me tonight. Help me tonight. I want Brother Bartlett to have someone show me from the Scriptures how I can know that I have eternal life. Is there somebody like that tonight? I'd love to pray for you. Then we'd like to help you right out of the Bible. Pray for me. I need to be saved. Someone tonight, would you raise your hand? And I'd love to pray for you. We want to help you straight from God's Word. You can know that you have eternal life. Is there somebody like that tonight? Pray for me. Pray for me. Father, we ask now as we give Your invitation that You would crush our hearts. And I pray the Word of God would do what only the Word of God can do, deep in the souls of Your children. And Lord, may there be holy choices made at this altar tonight. I come in Jesus' mighty name. Would you stand together prayerfully tonight? And as we begin to play that invitation song, if you're not saved, of course, we invite you to come. Now tonight, if God deals in your heart as a Christian, this altar is a place to humble ourselves before our God and our King and say, Lord, it's not just a salvation I take, and it's not just Your blessings I want. You get my heart. You get my life. Jesus, I want You to be the Lord and the King over me. Would You come tonight as we pray for You? Thank you. So after a long, long night of fishing, Peter comes to the shore with a lot of nothing. And that morning he meets the Lord Jesus Christ, who has already saved him, who is already the master of his life. And now he is confronted, not on the worst day, it turns out to be the best day. What you gonna do, Peter? Are you willing to install the Lord Jesus Christ as the Lord and the King? And you know, I suppose a lot of people that day would have laughed at Peter and said, Peter, look what you're giving up. But I think we all know if Peter could show up here tonight, he would say, my, was that ever the greatest choice that I made? We can live for me, for the world, for stuff, or we can live for Christ, but we can't have both. Preacher.
Amen. You can look this way. Well, amen. What a great message. What a great message. Brother Brian, can we find, to see if we have number 391, and we'll sing that first verse of I'd Rather Have Jesus. If we don't have it, I think we know it well enough. We'll sing that as we close tonight. Hey, church, we have some offering envelopes. I don't know why I haven't got into that. We've got the offering plates here. We want to give our preacher a good offering. You can't pay a man for his preaching, but I was thinking today, Brother Swanky preached all day Sunday, and I know what that's like. And then he came back and did it again on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. And he'll get in the car tomorrow and drive to preach again. So it's going to be, it's going to be an investment in ministry. Investment in ministry. Again, we can't pay him for his preaching, but we certainly can give thanks and try to be a blessing to him, be a blessing to other folks. So I want us to give a great offering to our preacher. And if you'd like to be a part of that, then you'll get to reap some of the blessings. Amen. Let's sing. I'd Rather Have Jesus. It's number 391 if you need a songbook. I'd Rather Have Jesus Than Silver or Gold. Let's sing that together.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to.
Sunday, you're dismissed. Please don't hog all of Brother Swanky's time. Everyone would like to speak to him.